Hello there, and welcome to episode 5 of The Fate Master. This one's entitled The Secret Life of Bees, named after the Sue Kidd novel and the movie, starring Dana Owens, or the self-proclaimed Queen Latifah, and Dakota Fanning. So, when we last left off in episode 4, Artie and Cassie took an enchanted video game from one of their playmates, which, unbeknownst to them, foiled the plans of Queen Mab of the Fairies to use the game to drain glamour from the neighborhood children to fuel her war against the eldritch horrors that had invaded the Dreamin'. While visiting Sister Abbie, the convent's novitiate at Artie's orphanage, they followed her secretly to her rooftop beehives, where, as they hid inside the staircase bulkhead, they could hear Sister Abbie let out a distressed cry. So, episode 5 begins from within the rooftop bulkhead of the staircase. Artie and Cassie saw a few random bees flit by the open door. Artie then heard Sister Abbie pray to the Holy Spirit for strength, courage, and wisdom, and saw a flaming wind pass in front of the open door. When he and Cassie peeked out, Artie saw a tongue of flame over the head of Sister Abbie, who, examining her empty makeshift beehives, exclaimed distressfully that the hive had suffered from complete colony collapse. Now, complete colony collapse is what happens when a vast majority of worker bees in a colony die out. See, because the queen needs the nectar provided by these workers to nurse new bees, the entire colony collapses if the workers disappear. Melittologists and apologists still don't know what causes complete colony collapse, so it's a mystery. Seeing the children and warning them that they should not be on the roof, Sister Abbie wondered aloud what could have driven the bees from the hive, and, inspired by her divine wisdom, looked forlornly across town toward the foliage of Telesto Creek, behind Alger Hiss Middle School. You may have noticed a pattern in my game where institutions in Runehaven, Maryland are named after famous, or in this case, infamous, Marylanders. I did not do that with Telesto Creek, however. Telesto Creek is actually named after a water nymph mentioned in Hesiod's Theogony. So Artie and Cassie hiked to Telesto Creek so that they could find their way back from this distant frontier of the neighborhood. At least that's how it seemed to Artie, who had seldom been far from the orphanage. Artie left on telephone poles and mailboxes a trail of stickers from the Fairy Cycle Bicycle Shop, where, earlier in the day, the owner, Mr. Curtis, had recently given Artie a job to pay off a bicycle Artie wanted. Now, a fairy cycle is actually a real thing. It's one of those little bicycles for very, very small children who are too young to pedal or much less keep their balance. And so they just straddle the seat, and with their feet, they basically walk the cycle. That's a fairy cycle. So Artie and Cassie followed the creek, finding thousands of honeybees swarming in a bed of blue and purple cornflowers growing at the water's edge. Now, you may know cornflowers by their other name, the bachelor's button. These flowers are native to Europe, but they are naturalized in North America, Australia, and much of the Anglosphere. Cassie noticed a woman's bare foot, the only part of her not covered in bees, in the middle of the flower bed. Artie noticed it too, only when he looked through his newly modified magnifying glass with the fairy sight lens that he acquired from the broken goggles of the Knocker Smeeko workers. They poked the woman, who roused, seemingly not in the least distressed to be covered in bees. She identified herself as Ionula, but her friends call her Cornflower. And reminded of her friends, she called out to the water for her oceanid friend, Telesto, who had helped her escape an invasion of her home kingdom by monsters. Now, of course, these monsters are the Lovecraftian horrors cast as the villains in the video game Knights of Arctis Tour, sort of the game within this game. And you may recognize another theme here. Using a video game in the story that the main character is familiar with and plays in order to acquire skills that he later uses in a conflict in the larger story. So, for example, The Last Starfighter or Back to the Future. In The Last Starfighter, the main character uses the video game to learn starfighting skills. In Back to the Future, we learn that Marty is a six-gun sharpshooter because he practiced on a video game that involved a first-person shooter scenario. There may be other films of the era that use this trope. I can't think of any off the top of my head, but if you could think of some, go ahead and leave them in the comments. So, Artie and Cassie spotted the old lady witch's cat nearby, watching with a darkling light in its eyes. Cassie welcomed Cornflower to the queendom of Caslandia, and suddenly a giant clawed, green, scaled hand reached out of the creek and grabbed Cornflower and Cassie, pulling them towards the water, kicking and screaming, and frightening away the cat. Artie lanced the hand with a giant fallen branch, causing it to release the maidens and recede back into the creek. Cassie, grateful for Artie's intercession, benighted Artie Sir Artholomew, and did the same to the flower maid, dubbing her Dame Cornflower. Having a bad feeling about the spying feline, the three made their way to the old lady witch house to find the fleeing cat. Artie sneaked through the front gate, up the cement path between the two lawns of grass, up to her porch, climbed the creaky steps, painstaking footstep by painstaking footstep, went over to the porch window, peered over her flower box, and saw through the window the old lady witch in her parlor feeding and talking to the cat, whom she addressed as Grizel. Dried up weeds from the window flower box caused Artie to feel a sneeze coming on, and so he jumped off the porch, his sneeze alerted the cat, who darted through the cat door and hissed at Artie from atop the porch as Artie ran with Cassie and Cornflower out of the yard and back to the street. The old lady witch opened the front door and yelled for them all to get off her lawn. Clanging her cane against copper pitchers of water just inside the doorway on a table, making a loud racket that was immediately followed by thunder overhead. Picking up one of her copper pitchers, she walked outside onto the porch and began casually watering the weeds in her flower box, and a heavy rainfall suddenly began. Though the sudden rainstorm impeded their visibility, Cassie and Artie managed to run back to Cassie's house, but when they arrived there, they noticed that Cornflower was no longer with them. Forced to find shelter from the drenching rain, Cassie went inside her house, and Artie returned to the orphanage, soggy and shaken. The next morning, the nuns took the orphans to confession before Sunday Mass. Feeling terrible about leaving Cornflower behind, Artie decided for the first time to enter the confessional. Now, for those of you who aren't Catholic, confession is one of the seven sacraments. It involves going into a confessional box, which is divided in two, with a screen window in the dividing wall and a kneeler on the side of the person doing the confessing. Nowadays, you could do confessions face-to-face without the screen, but in the 80s, you could still do the confession in the confessional box with the screen. And on the other side of the screen is the confessor, the priest. And so the person doing the confessing kneels down and prays to God the Father to forgive me, Father, for I have sinned, and then confesses all of his sins to God the Father. The confessor then gives the person making the confession some penance. Usually it's some prayers or something, say three Hail Marys and an Our Father, something like that. But it can be something more active. For example, if you steal a candy bar from a store and you confess that, the priest could conceivably say, go back to the store and give the store owner the $1.50 that you owe him for the candy bar. You don't have to tell him what it's for. Just, you know, make this right. It could be something like that. So, behind the screen, the disembodied voice told Artie that he had heard Sister Abbie's prayers and had come to investigate the trouble. An odd thing to say, but Artie was new to this whole confession thing, so he wasn't sure what to make of that. Artie confessed clumsily that a monster had attacked from Telesto Creek, and the confessor asked Artie to show him. Artie agreed and exited the confessional, and an androgynous person emerged from the confessor's box, giving the name Sandy. Artie led Sandy toward the exit of the church, and on the way, Sandy noticed the Eucharistic tabernacle behind the altar, shaped like the Ark of the Covenant. Now, again, the tabernacle is usually a golden receptacle that is housed in an alcove behind the altar, where the Eucharist, or the bread, the host, the body of Christ is housed. And because Christ is the Logos, the Word. And the tabernacle is a spiritual replica of the Ark of the Covenant, which contained the Ten Commandments, the Word of God given to Moses. It's usually shaped like a domed tower, but there are some that are constructed in the likeness of the Ark of the Covenant itself, and that's what this church in Runehaven has. So, seeing the Ark-shaped tabernacle, Sandy stopped in his tracks and claimed to be one of the cherubim depicted atop the Ark, which interested Artie, but they said no more about it and they left the church. Now, I should pause here to mention that the proliferation of angels and Catholic iconography in the story is not there for the purpose of proselytization. Rather, it is a bona fide trope of the Dresdenverse, one-third of the setting of this game by the request of Rob, the player who plays Artie. In the Dresdenverse, there's this trope, this concept called true faith, which basically means if a person has true faith or truly has faith in whatever faith he or she believes in, then that faith can manifest itself in the material world as like a supernatural power. And, you know, also, aside from the fact that it's a trope of the Dresdenverse, Artie is an orphan, and I happen to place him just reflexively in a Catholic orphanage, so there are lots of opportunities for the sort of iconography and true faith to be integrated into the story. Now, if you know who Sandy is, leave it down in the comments, and if you have more information on the true faith trope from reading the Dresden novels, please enlighten us in the comments. So, Artie led Sandy to the creek where he and Cassie had been attacked, and Sandy immediately recognized the giant gouges in the ground as the claw marks of Dagon. Sandy touched Artie's forehead, and Artie was suddenly able to recite from memory chapter 5 of the Old Testament book of Samuel, reciting how the statue of the pagan deity Dagon had twice fallen in the presence of the Ark of the Covenant. Now, that's a real Bible story, the first book of Samuel, chapter 5, verse 1. But I find it interesting that H.P. Lovecraft, the author of the Cthulhu mythos, uses this specific biblical pagan deity as one of his eldritch horrors. Meanwhile, Cassie took to her bicycle to return to where she had last seen her benighted flower nymph. And benighted is kind of like a play on words. It's in the game it's kid talk for the real word knighted. But there actually is a real word, benighted, without the K. And it means, and I quote, "In a state of pitiful or contemptible intellectual or moral ignorance, typically owing to a lack of opportunity." End quote. So this is kind of a meta joke, like Cassie being a self-proclaimed queen, but a commoner puka fairy is ignorant of the actual terminology that the nobles that lawfully claim their noble titles use. So approaching the old lady witch house, Cassie saw no sign of Cornflower, but instead found all of the witch's flower boxes previously growing nothing but dried up weeds, now overflowing with cornflowers. And that's our cliffhanger. I hope you enjoyed it. I have a few minutes left, so I'd just like to address something that I talked about in an earlier episode. So I was talking about running games in a decade-long era, and I said that this particular game is just set in 1980, and no specific year, and that the idea came from a game I ran that was set in 1970. And again, no specific year. There was actually an intermediary game, and it was a game set in 1960. And I actually co-created that game with my friend Michelle. We took turns GMing that game. We used the Fate system. And it was set in 1960s Las Vegas. It was like a crime story. But Michelle raised an interesting point. She asked me when we were... Actually, after we had already started the campaign and we were a few sessions in, she said to me, I guess when her turn to GM came up, she said, what year are we setting it in? And I said, well, you know, I think we've decided we're just, it's kind of just in the 60s, you know, we're not specifying a year. And she said, yeah, but the question is important to determine the tone of the game. And I said, well, you know, I mean, won't our rule of thumb suffice that if something needs to have happened, it has happened. And if we don't need that event for our narrative, it hasn't happened or it's just indeterminate. And she said, well, no, because, you know, when President John F. Kennedy was assassinated in 1963, that changed the entire tenor of the decade. You know, prior to the Kennedy assassination, the 1960s was more like the 1950s in tone. And after the assassination of President Kennedy, the 1960s became a very different time. And it took on the tenor that we think of when we think of the 60s after the assassination of Kennedy, after November 22nd, 1963. Everything changed. And, you know, that's a good point. So I guess the same could be said about the 1970s, say, with perhaps Star Wars, you know, especially maybe not if you're running a game that takes place in the adult world, like I was running in the 70s. It was a 1970s sort of action adventure hero game. But if you're running a kid game in the 1970s, then absolutely, 1977 is the watershed. You know, May 22nd, 1977 is the watershed date where everything changed for kids in the 1970s, because prior to that, as I like to say, we used to play cowboys and Indians, and then, you know, and up until May 21st, and then on May 22nd, 1977, we started playing Star Wars, and everything changed. So that you know, if I were running this Childling game in the 70s, that might be an important question to ask. And I think it certainly would challenge that rule of thumb of, well, if you need it to happen, it happens, and if you don't need it to happen, it can be indeterminate. I don't know that there is a watershed date in the 1980s. I mean, I think perhaps when video killed the radio star on MTV, that was the defining moment, and that took place on August 1st, 1981. So that was kind of early in the decade, early enough that really all of the 1980s really kind of shares the same tone and shares the same sort of iconography and tropes and everything. So those are some thoughts I had that challenged my rule of thumb. That if it needs to happen narratively, it's happened, and otherwise it's indeterminate. But there's a good argument to be made that certain events in a decade can really change the tenor and the feel of the decade. So that's it. I hope you enjoyed this episode. Tune in next time, same fate channel, to find out what happens to our intrepid Dresden Childling heroes. Bye, everybody.